course, the man that currently holds that record is this man, Gary Beck, at 5.391 seconds ET. Now, in round two, Gary Beck faces Frank Bradley.
This is Frank Bradley, Paul, pulling through the water to accomplish the tire-smoking burnout. It's a crowd-pleaser to be sure, but it's also part of the performance. The idea is to heat up the tire and lay down some hot, sticky rubber. The crew's always careful to bring the driver right back in his tracks. Bradley, for obvious reasons, nicknamed the Beard. He's from Napa, California.
Gary Beck, the reigning world champion, has 172 runs in less than 6 seconds. He leads in that category. When the day is done, that number one comes off his machine as he gives up the world title.
Certainly nobody likes to lose any one of these world championships, but Joe's had a tremendous year. We did manage to win three races. Generally, that's good enough to win a title, but he did so well and won three himself and set the record and did so well at all the others. I mean, he deserves to be world champion. He had a great race team. But we'll go after him again next year.
So Gary Beck wants to still prove that he has that world champion stuff. He would love to have a victory here today in the World Finals. There's Gary Beck in the near lane. Frank Bradley in the far lane.
So many fans, Paul, just expect Gary Beck to be the number one qualifier. Not this weekend. He's number three. Frank Bradley in the number seven spot. Just one qualifying run for Bradley. Look at Beck. He has gone like a rocket. The instant advantage goes to Gary Beck. He defeats Frank Bradley in round two.
Gary Beck wanders just a bit off the line, comes across with a 563, 248 miles an hour. Now, he is the reigning world champion. He took the title away from Shirley Muldowney, three-time world champion, who at the Grand Nationals at St. Aaron, Canada, suffered a terrible accident. We ask her son, John, how is she now?
She's doing good. She's in great spirits, and she's started to answer all of her cards that have come in from friends and fans throughout the whole country. She sounds good, you know.
And don't be surprised, Paul, if Shirley Muldowney doesn't give the keys to the family top fuel dragster to that young man's son, John. Here is the world's fastest driver, Joe Amato. And speed, Paul, in the first round may have caused Amato some problems. He ran 262 miles an hour but hurt the engine, and the businessman from Pennsylvania has had to install a spare power plant.
He faces the world's largest potato farmer, Larry Miner, who owns the Pomona track record at 5.40. Amato in the near lane, Miner in the far lane. They both inch up. Bit of psychology played here. Who can out-psych the other as they come to the line? Amato spins the tires just a bit on the start, fights for control, and Miner comes across. Miner at a 5.56, 239 miles an hour. Joe Amato, the world champion, is out.
And Paul, Amato is in trouble instantly. Now watch the rear tires. As soon as you see a little bit of smoke, that means he's lost traction. The driver feels that and gets off the throttle. As he gets off the throttle, Larry Miner just streaks away from him.
Looking at it again, now watch Amato's engine. There's a puff of smoke as the pistons begin to burn. The engine is going away. Larry Miner comes on to the win. Let's go to the shutdown area now, and Steve.
It can get mighty lonely down here when you lose a race, can it, Joe?
Yeah, it's the way it is, Steve. It's tough when you lose, you know. It's hard on the crew and all, but he ran better than us. The car shook, and it just didn't do what it was supposed to do, and that's racing.
You know, you said earlier, you told us earlier, you were going to try to set the record to prove to the Southern California fans what a Joe Amato was really capable of. Did you maybe overpower the racetrack trying to go for that record?
No, we had to change the motors. We had something happen to that motor, a minor thing, but it caused the cam to get grooved up, so we had to put a different motor in, and it was a little different combination, so it kind of threw us off track a little bit.
So Joe Amato, the world champion, is out in the early going in front of a record crowd of over 30,000 people. We'll be back. Drag racing, and to show you just how much this crowd here at the LA County Fairgrounds appreciated this man, here is Big Daddy on the return road as he came down at the conclusion of the first round, a standing ovation.
And Paul, we'll be seeing Big Daddy Don Garlitz in second round action right after this race. In the far lane is Denver Schutz from Fresno, California. Fans who drop by the Schutz trailer of the pits get a big handful of raisins because he's a raisin rancher.
And he will face Shannon Stewart, who is from just up I-10 in Riverside, California, in what is his best performance in his 3 years in drag racing.
Paul, this was Shannon Stewart in the near lane in qualifying, and I'm sure at this very moment he doubted if he'd ever even see the day of eliminations. Look at this, a moonshot. The white car in the near lane, a little light on the front end, got too much traction. Shannon tried to feather it down, but bent the front end up badly. Crew has done a good job of getting this car back into action, and he was victorious in round one.
Out came the hammers and wrenches, got them front end of the machine put back together, and he is on the line now.
Denver Schutz has far more driving experience than Shannon Stewart. In fact, he was one of the first drivers in the sport to break into the 5 second elapsed time zone. Shannon Stewart has only been racing 3 years, but has been quite a surprise here this weekend.
Stewart launches hard, weaves just a bit, maintains his lead, and it's Stewart across the line with a 569, 250 miles an hour. So inexperience pays off as Stewart moves up to the next round. And the crowd begins now to go nuts. Here he is. The expression here at Pomona is Big is back. There he is. Big Daddy Don Garlitz completes his burnout. And they are loving it here today. He faces Gary Ormsby.
Now, Gary Ormsby, a very worthy opponent, Paul. Ormsby won the Winter Nationals, the opening race of the season, right here at the fairgrounds. An automobile dealer from Sacramento, California, and a fine race car driver.
Of course, Ormsby faces the challenge from the formidable Don Garlitz, who has been winning for over two decades.
This girl of mine, oh, in a car now, she was new, old and broke now.
Daddy comes to Pomona with a record of over 23 Nationals titles.
Big Daddy, Don Garlitz, the name that really means drag racing in the United States, disappeared for a while. Now you're back with a vengeance. Why?
Well, you know, I took a few years off putting my museum together. I built a museum for the sport, drag racing. And, you know, it took about 4 years out of my life. We worked, my wife and I worked real hard on that thing, spent a lot of money on it, and you just can't do two things at once.
You, A.J. Foyt, you guys are too old to be doing this, aren't you?
That's what they keep telling me.
When you first started in the sport, did you have any idea you'd be seeing 260s and full fields in the fives?
Of course not. You know, we run 85 miles an hour, 20 seconds in the quarter, and we were just having fun, just a bunch of kids, you know. It's I never dreamed the sport would become what it has.
If you dream a little bit now, what will the sport become? Do you have any idea?
Well, I guess it's going to get lots bigger, that's for sure, and we're going to go lots faster.
And you can bet if they go faster, Big Daddy at age 52 will be right there with them. Garlitz the near lane, Ormsby the far lane. Garlitz on the line, it's a close race. Garlitz drifts toward the center line. Continues to accelerate. Garlitz of 555, 260.
Well, Big Daddy knew Gary Ormsby was there all but that last 100 feet of the racetrack. Ormsby in it all the way. No one has the Garlitz touch. He is at one with this machine. The perfect balance between clutch and throttle. The front wheels just dancing on the pavement.
The dragster stresses as he comes from the line. Here's where Big Daddy won it, pulling toward the line as he runs through the traps.
Well, Don, you must like those 260-mile-an-hour times, because there's another one for you at about a 551.
Great. Now, you need them out here. These guys are tough.
You know, you had never run 260, really, the U.S. Nationals. Is it do you feel that in the seat of your pants? Can you tell that kind of mile an hour?
Yes, sir, you sure can. It is a ride down here. I mean, those traps go pip, pip, pip.
And from the first pip to the last pip is 132 feet. Well, the semifinal rounds are coming up. Gary Beck will face his car owner, Larry Miner, and Don Garlitz will face Shannon Stewart.
Paul, this is the car to beat for the Funny Car World Championship. The beautiful red Firebird driven by Mark Oswald. Now, these 1,800-pound tube-frame missiles are required to maintain the essence of a production automobile. That's why the fiberglass Firebird body, and that's why the engine is in front of the driver as it is in your car or mine. Now, with a 3,000-horsepower supercharged nitro-burning engine in front of the driver, from his standpoint, these could be called formula scary. Oswald is protected as much as possible by an aluminum bulkhead called the firewall. And in that wall are two Lexan plastic windows. Should they light up red, he knows there's problems, and he activates the onboard fire extinguisher system, hoping to extinguish the blaze. And as we've seen before here on Sports World, these cars don't always come back to their pit area quite as pretty as they were when they left.
And talk about terrifying. This was in the qualifying, Billy Williams in the right lane, heading for the traps, and then suddenly, fire erupts around the car. Here it is from the forward angle. Now watch this machine. It first explodes with fire, and then suddenly the fiberglass begins to come apart. Now, thanks to NHRA safety, Williams is able to drive this machine to a stop, and he is uninjured. There the crew looks over the car, and Billy Williams talked with Steve Evans.
Well, the obvious first question, are you okay, Billy?
Yeah, I'm okay.
What on earth happened? I've never seen one like that.
I have no idea myself. It just seemed like it must have started to get lean because the car really started to run good down here. It felt like it really started to pick up, and then all of a sudden, just boom.
And your first experience with the funny car so far certainly has not been a pleasant one.
It hasn't been great. I like it, though. It's neat. I'll get used to it.
You'll be back.
Yeah, I'll be back.
Fire off in the fate of the funny car. We're ready now. Second round of eliminations. There is Sherm Gunn. Now he will face four-time world champion Don Prudhomme.
First order of business is the crowd-pleasing burnouts. But they're more than just showbiz. The idea for Don Prudhomme here is to lay down some hot, sticky tracks of rubber, back up in them for maximum traction. Don Prudhomme, as you said, Paul, the four-time world champion, still based in Granada Hills, California, has had less than a perfect season this year.
He faces Sherm Gunn from Azusa, California, who has never won a Nationals title, but in the first round turned out to be a giant killer against Kenny Bernstein in the near lane. Now look at Gunn as he nails it, gets the whole shot on Bernstein, and goes on to win.
Bernstein ran 0.06 of a second quicker and lost. There's nothing more humbling to a drag racer than being left on like that.
And Bernstein was totally defeated.
Well, those high hopes for a world championship, at least this year, have come to an end for Kenny Bernstein as Sherm Gunn gets there first. Kenny, what happened up there?
Oh, I don't know, Steve. He ran pretty good. I was a little late. I don't know what his ETs were.
He ran a 5.95. I believe he ran a little quicker.
Yeah, I was late. I saw him leave. Reactions weren't there, and it's one of those days.
Well, I know you're real down right now, and we'll let you get back to the pits and try to get a little happier. Kenny Bernstein is all done for this season.
Kenny Bernstein, Texas millionaire and restaurateur, takes losing very, very hard. Sherm Gunn is ready. He faces Don Prudhomme, who wins 75% of the time.
Well, Don Prudhomme has got to be wondering right now what he's dealing with. Prudhomme saw him get by Bernstein and knows that he better not be late at the starting line or Gunn will drill him just like he did Bernstein.
No question about it. Sherm Gunn is hot today. They move up to stage.
Sherm Gunn and Don Prudhomme leave dead even. Sherm Gunn gets near the center line. Prudhomme shuts it off. It is Sherm Gunn advancing yet another round.
Something goes away on Prudhomme's machine. It's Gunn with a 5.98, 224 miles an hour. Gunn continues his march forward here in the World Finals. So Sherm Gunn moves ahead. He's now knocked out Bernstein and Prudhomme. We'll be back right after this. Racing as Rick Johnson prepares to face Ed McCullough. And here, Sherm Gunn is proving to be just a bit of a spoiler.
This is the classic case of local boy makes good. You could almost throw a rock and hit Sherm Gunn's race car shop. You've been building these cars long enough for other people. Finally, you get a chance to go beat some of your customers.
Finally do. We're having fun.
Kenny Bernstein first, now the snake. Wow.
Well, we just take them as we can.
Of course, your driving is what beat Bernstein.
I think it was. We were out on him quite a bit, and I was watching him coming down through here. And he just couldn't pass me.
You're going to need more than 5.90s to continue through this field, though, unless you've got this kind of luck all day.
Well, maybe we got a little bit of luck on our side for a change.
Somebody once said I'd rather be lucky than good.
Really? Thank you.
Sherm Gunn, he's having fun. A new face on our Sports World Drag Racing coverage.
Two big names, Bernstein, Prudhomme, fall to Gunn. Now it's Rick Johnson and Ed McCullough.
Rick Johnson just recently took over the reins of this car owned by Ronan Leon. This is only Rick's second national event. Now, his competition is back after a five-year layoff. That is Ed the Ace McCullough from Sanger, California, driving the Oldsmobile car owned by Larry Miner. McCullough had lane choice by virtue of running the quicker elapsed time in the previous round. And surprisingly, Paul, he takes that left-hand lane. Most drivers with lane choice take the near lane.
There's the Christmas tree. They come into the pre-stage condition. Now they're staged. One yellow light, and they're off. McCulloch with a hole shot. Johnson on the charge, but it's Ed the Ace all the way across the line. 584, 236 miles an hour, but some very expensive-looking smoke coming out of that motor.
Indeed, Paul. Here in replay, in the far lane, we see McCullough. His car noticeably launches harder. Now, McCullough fell off of his blistering pace in the first round. That was a 5.70, so he slowed down 0.14 of a second, no doubt due to an awful lot of piston smoke right at the finish line.
As he comes across the line, there you see it. That's a great chunk of money pouring out into the air here at Pomona. And that brings up Billy Meyer, who still has a chance to take the world championship away from Mark Oswald. He will face Dale Poldy.
And Dale Poldy is having a fine weekend, Paul. Ran a career best of 5.69 in this beautiful red car.
Capaldi has been a full-time professional drag racer since he was 17 years old. Only Myers started younger at 16. Dale Poley is willing to spend whatever hours and dollars it takes Paul to succeed as a professional putty car racer. Billy Meyer had an opportunity along with Kenny Bernstein to go into the wind tunnel for the first time with these cars. Meyer came out of that wind tunnel and won the very next race, so he learned a bunch.
Billy Meyer in the far lane has twice been runner-up in the world championship fight. He would like to finish this day not as a bridesmaid once again. He can spoil the world championship for Mark Oswald. But first, he has to get by Dale Poldi. They launch. It is Billy Meyer all the way. Meyer with a 573, 253 miles an hour.
And, Paul, Billy Meyer has been equating this day as if it was a football game. And he told me earlier, this is the long bomb. Everybody go long. So Billy Meyer had all the nitro and all the blower boost possible to get by Dale Poldi here.
And so Billy Meyer, with this victory, pours the pressure onto Mark Oswald. Let's go down to the far end. Steve is with Billy Meyer.
A 573 to a 579. Billy Meyer, that was the most interesting funny car race.
Yes, it was. I had a valve that I needed to get shut off down there, and I couldn't shut it off, and I almost hit the guardrail there, and it looked like, felt like it made a pretty good move. I was jamming on that stupid lever.
It got mighty close. And then what happened on the starting line? It looked like you overstaged?
Yeah, well, he had gone on stage, and I was trying to hurry up and get everything done, and when I blinked in, I just went too far in, and that's just part of the game, I guess.
Well, that'll rattle a lot of drivers. Instead, you had an advantage.
Yeah, it seemed to work. Now we just need to see what Oswald does, see if I can get the ball back here.
So Billy Meyer's Hail Mary pass worked this time. He steps up to a 573. Let's go back to the starting line and see how Mark Oswald is doing.
Well, Billy Meyer is smiling, but Mark Oswald is ready. As the engine is fired in the Candies and Hughes funny car, he is ready to go. And he is extremely popular here in Southern California. Some say he'll go not only for the world championship, but a bit further.
And Mark has a chance to ice the world title right now, Paul. If he can win here and run over 258 miles an hour, he will back up his earlier speed record set in the first round. That'll do it for him. Mark Oswald from Cincinnati, Ohio, could be the world champion in the next few seconds.
Of course, he still has to get past Tom McEwen, who is the second man to travel at 260 miles an hour in a funny car. He is a big opponent to Oswald's chance at a world championship at this moment. Oswald's wife, Janie, stands just behind the line at their support truck, apprehension all over her face. It's not just this round, it's the world championship that hangs in the balance.
This is the 11th race of the year, Paul, and it's all come down possibly to this run. Remember, that record could be set right now. Tom McEwen, after 20 years of racing, has never been tougher than he is this year. Janie Oswald looks on.
McEwen jumps off the line, but then gives up. Oswald pours on the power and screams through the finish with a 593, 252 miles an hour.
Tears of joy from Janie Oswald, but the title is still not put away. He did not run fast enough to back up that record we talked about. So the $40,000 still eludes Mark Oswald. Paul, as we look at this again, I think you'll see in the far lane that the front wheels come up in the air on Tom McEwen's car. When he gets off the pedal a little bit to set him down, the rear tires unload and lose traction.
Mark Oswald is one step closer to a world championship. Let's
Pro Stock, the factory hot rods. Their season came down to two men vying for the world title. Warren Johnson of Norcross, Georgia, has won three races in a row coming into the world finals. Lee Shepard, Arlington, Texas, the rear and Morrison Camaro. If he wins the world title, he'll be the first to ever win four consecutive times. The points are so close that the driver that goes furthest in eliminations today will be the world champion. If they both were to go out in the same round, then Warren Johnson would be the world champion. This was earlier in first round action. Warren Johnson in the near lane is out first over Ricky Smith in the Ford Thunderbird, but suddenly Warren Johnson does not have his usual power. It is Ricky Smith in a tremendous upset at 789 to a very slow for Warren, 7.97. So back in the staging lanes, Lee Shepard knew what he had to do. If he could, here in the first round, defeat Joe Lapone, he would retain his number one, be the first driver to ever win the Pro Stock title four times in a row. So the world championship came down to this first round race. It is Lee Shepard and Joe Lapone. Joe Lapone is out first. Shepard not wanting to risk a red light. Shepard drives around. He is the new world champion at 7.71 seconds to a losing 7.79. So the Lee Shepard, Rear and Morrison crew very happy as they head back to the pits. And Lee Shepard has now advanced to the semifinal round of Pro Stock, and that's where we pick up the action. And this crowd of 30,000 plus is ready for the first race in the semifinals. It pits two Trans Ams against each other. In the near lane is Butch Leal of Black Lick, Ohio. In round number one, Butch got around the powerful Chrysler car of Reed Wisnett. And in round number two, it was Butch Leal, for many years known as the California Flash, getting by Ronnie Manchester. Were it not for a back problem suffered some years ago, Butch Leal might well have become a professional golfer. He still can shoot a scratch game. His opponent over in the far lane, Don Kuntz, has done very well in this season of professional drag racing. He finished number six last year, could finish even higher if he gets by Leal here in the semis. So leaping towards the starting line where they'll stage is Don Kuntz in the far lane, Butch Leal in the near lane. Now, these are 500 cubic inch motors. That's the maximum, 2,350 pounds with the driver, four-speed transmissions. Butch Leal is known as an artist on that starting line. Let's see if he can get away first over Don Kuntz. Moving up very carefully, they'll bring the engines up to almost 9,000 RPMs and literally slide that left foot off the clutch. Leal is ready. Don Kuntz is finally ready. Don Kuntz leaves too soon. A red light disqualifies the car in the far lane. Butch Leal goes on to the final round of the Winston World Finals. The black car in the near lane wins it at 7.74 seconds and even 180 miles an hour. Watch the tree, you see the lights, and before the circuit was complete to green, Don Kuntz moved. It bypassed green and went right to red for instant disqualification of Don Kuntz. Kuntz was gambling there. He did not have quite the performance of Butch Leal and just thought, if I get the whole shot. Well, here is Etta Glidden lining up her husband, Bob Glidden, in the Ford in the near lane. And this is the Pro Stock race the fans came to see. Bob Glidden and Lee Shepard, the two responsible for 9 world championships between them. Bob Glidden of Whiteland, Indiana, in the 7-Eleven Chief Auto Parts Ford Thunderbird, a very aerodynamically sound car. And here's the man who today clinched his fourth world title, very soft-spoken Lee Shepard of Arlington, Texas. Shepard will wear the number one for at least one more year. Shepard in the far lane, Glidden in the near lane. We'll watch to see if there's an advantage for either driver. They leave right together. Lee Shepard in the far lane trying to match wheels with Glidden, but Glidden is starting to stretch it out. It is going to be Bob Glidden. Low elapsed time of the day. Etta is more than pleased. 7.62 at 181 miles an hour. Lee Shepard knew it was all over at half track and just threw in the towel, coasting through at 8.04 seconds. The crowd is...
Final round, funny cars at the World Finals. This is the moment of truth for Mark Oswald. He can win it all right here. A world championship is within his grasp.
And his opponent, Ed McCullough, right now just hoping and praying that the engine change was made successfully. Paul, they love to tell you that all of these engines are alike, but usually it takes at least one run to tune up a new motor.
Well, there's plenty to worry about when you bring them to the line. For Oswald, it could be a world championship. McCullough comes out hard, but now it's Oswald as he screams toward the world championship, and he's done it. Mark Oswald wins the round, wins the world championship with a 5.79.
Well, I tell you, Paul, Ed McCullough gave him plenty of reason for concern, because 100 feet out, McCullough was in front.
Watch Ed McCullough in the near lane as he gets the hole shot, powers his way off the line, but then it is Oswald all the rest of the way. Let's go to the far end, and Steve Evans.
Let there be no doubt about it. The man taking off his shiny red helmet is the world champion, Mark Oswald, and you could be the event winner. You're going into the final round.
Yeah, well, we get greedy. We win one, we won it all.
How'd the car feel?
Felt real good that time. You know, a lot better than before. Last round, it was a little weak. You know, we almost made a big mistake there, but luckily we got through that.
A big top speed might be enough to back up that record.
Yeah, I don't know. It should be close.
We'll check on that, and good luck to you in the final.
Thank you, Steve.
Well, Steve, he just missed it by the flicker of an eye, but nevertheless, he is the world champion. Still, though, with one round to go, Sherm Gunn, the giant killer, faces now another giant who is once again, for the third time, the bridesmaid. He's second in the world point standing, and I'm speaking, of course, of Billy Meyer.
And Billy Meyer has got to be wondering right now, Paul, what is a Sherm Gunn, and why is he here in the semifinals? Here's a fellow that's only gone past the first round once in national competition. Look at Sherm Gunn and Billy Meyer. They are head-to-head.
Billy Meyer pulls the hole shot, but Sherm Gunn drives it right on through to the end, and Sherm Gunn comes up with yet another victory. He's knocked another big name down.
Shermgun so alert on the starting line, but Billy Meyer was right with him. Shermgun has that consistency. He doesn't overpower the racetrack. Here, they're looking over at each other, Paul. You know they can see the other car in their peripheral vision. Suddenly, Sherm is behind.
But he continues to lay down the power. It's still Meyer in front, but he picks up speed at the end, and Gunn wins it. Let's go to the shutdown area.
This has got to be the biggest upset the entire funny car season. Sherm Gunn goes into the final round against the new world champion Mark Oswald. How does it feel?
Great.
How many years have you been trying this?
God, about 20, I think.
Another overnight success.
Not an overnight success, but just perseverance.
Well, you know, unless this luck continues, and skill for that matter, but still, you're going to need more than 590s to beat that red car.
I know it, but we've done it so far. Consistency.
Anything you can do to try to whittle down that elapsed time?
Well, we're going to look at it. We're going to try.
Sherm Gunn continues to slug his way through the world finals. Here are the pairings as we prepare now for the final round. Now, finals of drag racing, semi-final round, Top Fuel. This is Paul Page with Steve Evans. And we will see the Southern California favorite, a man with over 20 years in the sport, this man, Big Daddy Don Garlitz, as he fires up, ready to face Shannon Stewart.
And Paul, when Big Daddy decided to re-enter the sport on a serious basis, he took this car right off the museum floor in Ocala, Florida. It's a four-year-old machine, the chassis designed by Garlitz himself. I had the pleasure of witnessing his triumph at the U.S. Nationals, and when he unloaded with a brand new engine and lots of fresh parts and pieces, courtesy of Art Malone, everybody said, well, that's fine, but the fuel system is the speed secret. It'll take him at least a year to figure that out. He unloaded at 261 miles an hour, and the handwriting was on the wall.
The Southern California crowd once again incredibly excited about the presence of Big Daddy back in the sport, the man who really made the rear-engine dragster work.
Indeed he did, Paul. After the accident that removed part of his foot at the old Lions dragster, Garlitz in 1971 debuted the rear-engine dragster and won right on this very quarter mile.
So Big Daddy Don Garlitz, 23 national wins to his record. He would like to etch another one yet into the record books. At age 52, the oldest man who is consistently winning in motorsports.
And by contrast, his competition is a hungry young rookie named Shannon Stewart, who we saw involved in that giant wheel standing qualifying. I asked him about racing Don Garlitz.
Yeah, it was quite an experience. I went and watched him race a lot of times when I was real young, and I didn't think I'd ever be racing beside him in a Top Fuel car.
I know he is well aware of you, called you a fast rising star in this sport. Nice words to hear from a legend.
Yeah, Don seems to be a real good guy. He's been helping us out, being pit next to him here, and we had a little problem this morning. He ran right over and gave us a hand with it.
Is that right?
So,
well, there's no friendship when those staging lights come on. That's all forgotten.
No, it's all for real then.
So Stewart simply has to face up to and beat the legend, Big Daddy, as he brings his machine up to stage, snaps the visor down, doesn't even look over at his competitor. Stewart in the far lane, Garlitz in the near lane. Up stage, Stewart pulls the hole shot on Garlitz. Garlitz pulls on the power. As Stewart's engine goes away, it's Garlitz with a 561, 256 miles an hour. Stewart loses the engine. Garlitz goes into the final round. Now, he will face the winner of this match, Larry Miner and Gary Beck, team machines.
In fact, they appear virtually identical on the starting line, Paul. It'll be Beck in the far lane, Larry Miner in the near lane. Only 2 years ago, Gary Beck taught his boss and car owner, Larry Miner, how to drive one of these machines. He was a very quick learner.
The pits have certainly been busy for this team. They have not only these two Top Fuelers, they also have a funny car that they have to keep maintenance on. And at the far end now, Steve is with Don Garlitz.
You've made the final round at the World Finals, Don, but the car slowed up a little bit. A 561, only 256.
Yeah, it was down on power just a little bit. We took a little power out because the last run we hurt a piston pretty good, and it needs that nitro back in it for the final for sure.
The car shook just a little bit?
It did. It lost some traction.
But the track seems to be holding up marvelously.
Track is real good.
Okay, well, let's go back to the starting line and see who Big Daddy's opponent is going to be in that final round. It's going to be one of the Larry Miner-owned cars. We know that for sure.
So the team moves up to the line. Gary Beck on the far side, Larry Miner on the near side. We've talked about staging, but what exactly does it mean?
It's an all-important part of any drag race, Paul. As Larry Miner and Gary Beck move up to the starting line, they inch forward very carefully, using that handbrake. Atop the Christmas tree, the pre-stage lights, one for each driver. All they do is tell the driver he's in starting proximity. The second yellow lights are the staging light. That means you're right on the starting line. The bottom yellow light, 0.4 seconds later, the green.
And they launch as it's Miner out in front, but Beck is on the charge. It's Beck as Miner goes away just at the line. Beck with a 560, 251 miles an hour. But what an incredible drive by Beck.
Great composure by the two-time world champion in the far lane. The car comes out, it's hooked up, everything's fine. Suddenly, you'll notice a little bit of smoke. Gary Beck gets off of that throttle. Had he stayed on it, the tires would have just blazed. He'd have lost for sure. Now he's back on the throttle hard and drives around Larry Miner.
Beck shows what a heads-up racer he is as he feels the tire shake, comes out, and then nails it, comes across the line.
Well, Gary Beck arrives down here with an obviously wounded race car. Anytime there's oil pouring out of one of these machines like this, it generally means that a connecting rod has been kicked to the pan or the side of the block, which is quite difficult to repair and generally indicates that an engine change will have to be made. So Gary Beck, his enthusiasm over beating the boss, Larry Miner, has certainly been tempered by this. Gary, we got a serious problem here.
Yeah, Steve, I guess it broke a rod. Must have happened, right? I didn't feel it. Must have happened right down the lights.
One of the engines, and I couldn't tell which car, sounded real funny down towards the finish line, like it was being turned on and shut off again.
I couldn't really tell. It was just going down through there, and I was just trying. Mine moved around quite a bit, so I was pretty busy trying to get mine set up for the finish line.
One thing we know for sure, that there's plenty of spare motors over there, but is there one that'll run this good?
Well, all the motors in the Light All-Star team are all the same. Funny car and Larry's car and my car, all exactly the same. All we do is have to change the pan on the funny car for the ground clearance. So, there's another one back there.
I'm sure Gary will be looking for the pick of the litter to go up against Don Garlett.
It is time for the finals among the professionals, beginning with Pro Stock. Bob Glidden, Whiteland, Indiana, the red, white, and blue Chief Auto Parts Ford Thunderbird. They push a button on the shifter that locks up the front brakes, allows him to get those huge rear slicks churning in the water to heat him up. His opponent, known as a starting line wizard, is Butch Leal of Blacklick, Ohio, in the Castrol GTX Pontiac Trans Am. Now, Glidden, as you've seen in earlier competition, has been the quickest driver on the grounds today as far as elapsed times are concerned. Leal is going to need one of those famous California flash hole shots that he's known for. Leal has been racing here at Pomona since drag racing literally began here almost 20 years ago. Glidden in the near lane, Butch Leal in the far lane. Ford versus Pontiac. As they move forward, neither wanting to stage first, Butch Leal putting a little psychological pressure on Glidden. Glidden doesn't seem to be buying it, just takes his time. Butch Leal is off the mark first. Butch Leal with a hole shot, but Bob Glidden is going to just outpower him with that hemispherical head aluminum Ford racing engine. Etta Glidden, the crew, they have worked so hard for 4 days, had a lot of problems in qualifying with the tires shaking, the car loose. But Glidden with a brand new national record of 7.61 seconds, 181 miles an hour. Congratulations from Starter Buster Couch. Watch the far lane. You can see it visibly. Butch Leal was off the mark first by at least 0.02 seconds. But as Bob Glidden sets the front wheels down at the top end of low gear, he takes command, never to be headed. Bob Glidden wins the World Finals event title here today. A happy man.
So an up-and-down season for Bob Glidden definitely ends on an up note. The event winner here at the World Finals. Congratulations, Bob.
Thank you, Steve. This is an up note. I think someone said we set the record at a 61.
That's right.
Great. I know Ed is overjoyed, and the sponsors are going to be happy, too. So it's been a good finish to a bad year.
Tell me about the starting line. What happened up there?
Nothing out of the ordinary. I knew Butch was going to do a little bit of some...
A little dance
for it. Yeah, and... he waited maybe a little bit too long, but there was no big deal.
Well, you played it very cool. He had a little of an advantage, maybe 0.02 seconds, but you gave him that. You had the power to do that.
I didn't give him anything. If he got it, he earned it.
Well, this could be a sign of big things to come. Next season, you're looking at your World Finals champion, Bob Glidden.
Appreciate it.
We're ready now for the final round in Funny Car. Gunn, he's faced every challenge that he possibly can, and he has conquered. Oswald, on the other hand, has the world championship completely wrapped up. He's coming into the round on a real high. It's going to be a terrific fight. Now, as they come into the staging lanes, engines fired, we're ready to go.
Mark Oswald has already earned $40,000 in bonus money by winning the world championship. Another $20,000 could be his if he wins here in the final round. But Oswald has had to replace engines. We were in his pit earlier as he and their very professional, well-uniformed crew attacked this project, installing a new $25,000 motor. By contrast, in Sherm Gunn's pits, well, they got their work done early, and his 9-year-old son, Little Sherm, had a chance to clean up Daddy's car. Quite a contrast in styles, Paul, and in financial backing as well.
Sherm Gunn is riding on a high coming into this final round. He's never done it before. This would be his first time, and it seems like he's been trying forever. Mark Oswald, he has the world title wrapped up. He'd sure like to add the world finals to that title at this moment, but the engine is the unknown quantity in Oswald's car. They stage a fire on Oswald's car. Sherm Gunn continues to pour the power, and Sherm Gunn has done it. He's done it.
The quickest Sherm Gunn has ever run in his life. Little Sherm headed back to the truck, and the deafening roar from the Southern California crowd.
Big day for father and son, but it was over right here. You see the fire light up on the engine, a loose line, who knows what, but the day was over there. Sherm Gunn continues to power on, and he wins the world finals. Down at the shutdown area, they are happy. Let's go to Steve.
Sherm Gunn accomplished nothing today other than beating Kenny Bernstein, Billy Meyer, Don Prudhomme, and the new world champion. Sherman, a great moment. Congratulations.
I'm pleased. I'm really pleased. I don't know what exactly happened to him, but he faded and I says, see ya.
And you did it in a car you built yourself, every nut and bolt.
Everything. Everything. The car's only 6 years old.
Oh, is that all? Just a youngster. Tell me about the race itself. You had to be a little nervous the first time in the final round.
No. Not really. I went to a lot of national events this year.
That helped, didn't
and
it?
That really helped.
It's that seasoning it takes sometimes.
Yeah, I'm pleased.
The biggest upset I can remember in a long, long time happened here today at Pomona. Sherm Gunn, the winner of the World Finals.
So congratulations to Sherm Gunn. The happiest member of that crew just may be his son, Little Sherm, as NHRA, the National Hot Rod Association, has done again what they do so well. Another exciting afternoon. The World Finals before a record crowd here in Pomona. The engines fire. We're ready for the final round. Tough fuel dragster, the World Finals.
And Paul, Gary Beck has one important thing going for him. He has lane choice. He earned that by having the quicker elapsed time in the semifinal round. Gary has selected the near lane, traditionally the quickest here at the fairgrounds in Pomona. Gary Beck with a thundering burnout trying to break in that new engine.
Two veterans here, of course, Don Garlitz has an advantage in knowing that he has had more time in preparation, and also knowing that Gary Beck is sitting there with a brand new engine. Beck has to worry about that power plant. Is it really in there properly? Is it ready to run? Garlitz has had all the time in the world. He tends to ignore the competition. Earlier, in Beck's pit, Steve Evans watched as they replaced that motor.
The story in Gary Beck's pit is an engine change. They're installing what they call a long block. You see it here. Everything is on the motor except for the clutch and the supercharger and fuel system. Those are two key ingredients that will come off of the engine that exploded in the semifinal round. So they'll swing it over to the chassis, drop it in, and have but a few minutes to get back to the staging lanes. But with this talent and the number of personnel involved here, you can bet it will be done.
So that's the motor that is fired now. Nobody really knows for sure, but they say about 3,000 horsepower being generated in each of these two power plants. Gary Beck is ready.
The longtime drag racing fan, so obviously riding with Big Daddy, hoping that he returns to the fairgrounds triumphantly. However, Paul, I think the new breed of fan, the high-tech guy and gal, they ride with Gary Beck. He epitomizes that.
There's Big Daddy as he inches up to the line. Beck took two burnouts. Don Garlitz has only taken one. He doesn't even glance over. It is his run against the tree, against the line. He doesn't really look at the other competitor. They inch toward the line. Beck a little bit forward. He comes up first. Now Big Daddy follows. They launch. Beck's wheels off the ground. Big Daddy nails it. Beck shuts it down, and it's Big Daddy going away. A 551, 261 miles an hour as Big Daddy wins the world finals.
And Paul, you could become a wealthy man right now if you were hawking Big Daddy souvenirs as this tremendous crowd leaves the fairgrounds. Their man has done it, defeated Gary Beck for the World Finals event title. Beck in the near lane, the front wheels instantly came off the ground. And they continued to rise higher and higher until Gary was forced to get off the throttle. He set him down almost like an airplane landing, smoke off of the front wheels. Beck battling for control. It's all over. He throws in the towel right here. Big Daddy wins it.
Big Daddy finishes with a victory in the World Finals. Herb Parks drives the truck with the crew on board down to pick up Big Daddy. Art Malone, former IndyCar driver, is there. Ed Donovan of Donovan Engine fame on the back of the truck. All down to congratulate Big Daddy Don Garlitz.
Don Garlitz waves to the fans who are blowing their horns as they exit the parking lot here at the Los Angeles County Fairgrounds. After a five-year layoff, Big Daddy comes back, wins the U.S. Nationals and the World Finals back-to-back. Don, a 551 again, over 260. Congratulations from Sports World.
Thank you very much, Steve. It's really been a pleasure to be here, believe me.
It was smooth on the starting line. Beck did what you figured he would do?
I don't know. I think Beck had some trouble. He was out. We were having a really good race, and it looked like his front end come up. And, of course, he had to back off, and he fell back rapidly then. But it was a real good race until that happened.
Well, the slogan is correct. Big is back. And that's definitely a threat for anybody else that drag races. Big Daddy Don Garlitz wins the World Finals at Pomona. Back-to-back victories with his win at Indianapolis in the U.S. Nationals. This is Paul Page for Steve Evans. So long from Pomona.